Thank you for the day. We thank you so much for the opportunity that we have together. Father, just this morning, our prayer is that you will inhabit this service, Father, that you will be here with us, that the songs we sing, the words we say will be those that are pleasing to you, and that, Father, we will glorify and honor you here. Father, just now, fill each of us with prayer in your Son's name. Amen. Amen.
Now is the time to Fill up my heart. mean your meditation today. We're going to sing a song for you. So just open your hearts and...
Come to my table of grace. Come, my child, and seek my grace. Search yourself within and confess your for my heart delights in those who will obey.
gather today, listen to your words, sing praise to your name. We thank you, Lord, that we was able to go out through this week and earn a living. Today, bring us an open heart, a cheerful heart. And Lord, we take this offering and bless it and do it your will. Help us grow. In Jesus' name, we want to grow in your name.
Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
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 And we will lift you up, higher and higher. And we will lift you up. Thank Jesus Christ, the Lord.
And it used to be that as we were growing up, we just tore in. You know, and you open them all up, and it's like, and 2 days later, I'm saying, oh man, when did you get that? Christmas, dummy. I didn't see you get that. Because we were so into it. As the dust settles, we finally saw what people got. And so at our house, we settled the dust before it happened. We hand out the gifts, and you put your little pile by your seat, and then we go around the room, and one at a time, we open a gift.
Yeah, but we sneak when you're not looking.
There are sinners in all groups. Cheaters. But we do it that way. I like to see what people got, and if they just Christmas at my mom's is, everyone gets everything and you're like, and then finally they sit on the table, ooh, I like this. So you trade. You know, you put yours down and think, no. But you do those things. The story I want to share with you today is Jesus coming into town, and it's close to Passover, and so he's going to go to the temple to worship. And what's taking place? You remember in the story? Sellers are everywhere selling pigeons and goats and all kinds of stuff like this. And he comes in and he does what?
Clears it all.
It's the only time you see Jesus really preach. And he's overturning tables and he's throwing things around. He's just like, get out, get out. Don't make my father's house a den of thieves. Do not turn my father's house into a marketplace. What he's saying. And we tell that story a lot of times and we go from there. But when the dust settled, we see the real story. When the dust settled, so I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2. Read along with us. We're going to start at verse 13. Matthew 2, 13. Kind of like this morning, everything's going on and there's people needing things. We had George here who lost his mom and just things going on. And it was a ramshackle. And as the dust settled, I noticed that we had Robbie and Lisa Robinson sitting in the back room. Now, I point them out to you because don't talk to them. They're from my college days and those records are sealed. The dust has long settled there. Okay? But it's good to have them with us. Matthew chapter 2, verse 13. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found men selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all of them from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. How dare you turn my father's house into a market?" His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." Then the Jews demanded of him, "What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this?" And Jesus answered to them, "Destroy this temple and I will raise it again in 3 days." The Jews replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. You see, a lot of times... Hey, did I tell you Matthew?
Yes. Yes.
All right. All right. Go to John chapter 2.
That was going crazy.
Go to John chapter 2. I wonder why I was looking wrong, but I read that. Andy said, "How are you going?" All right, John chapter 2. And you can read it on your own.
At least you have the right book.
It is as I read it to you. It was still in the Bible, you know. I could not figure out why your faces were like that. You were rattled. You were beside yourselves. When the dust settles, you'll see where we were and what we're doing. But the whole gist here of the story, if you listen to it, if you didn't read it with it, you could read it now on your own. But the gist is this, that Jesus came in and he cleared the temple. The real story happens after the dust settled and the temple was cleared. Which was what? What authority do you have to do this? How do you do this? You know? And Jesus says he's going to raise the temple in 3 days. You see their answers, right? Well, how are you going to do in 3 days what took 46 years to build? Here it is. They didn't get it. Read what it says there. And after he had raised himself, from the dead. His disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed in the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. At that point, they were just like, what in the world is he saying? Raise this temple in 3 days. They had to wait for the dust to settle. When was the dust going to settle? On the third day. From this point, when Jesus said this, it was just a constant hubbub of stuff. It was feeding the 5,000. It was doing all things. Life had just gotten to this point that people are following, and Jesus everywhere. I mean, he's just raising dust all over. When does the dust settle? Third day. On that third day, everything will be made clear. Everything that was cloudy, everything that was misunderstood, everything will be made clear. It says on that day, on the third day when he raised from the dead, then the disciples understood. When will we understand? When will we get it? How many of you know of the third day? You know of the third day? And we just celebrated with Easter. See, Easter came. That week that Jesus spent when he rode in on the donkey and Hosanna, Hosanna, that whole week that we talked about, all the things that went on, I mean, it was a whirlwind. That week, so much happened, it was just like beyond understanding. You know, how could I on Sunday be saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, King of Kings, King of Kings, and on Thursday be saying, Barabbas? How could I be saying, Lord of Lords, and then cry out, crucify? You see, the dust was flying that week. It was all over the place. Where were the disciples?
Hiding.
Locked in that upper room. Wondering if they were next. But then, the dust settled. When did the dust settle? The third day. What happened on the third day? Jesus rose from the grave. That third day made this story that happened so many years earlier here, a couple years earlier, make sense. Oh, on the third day, he's going to rebuild the temple. What's the temple? Jesus. Jesus, the temple. Jesus, the sacrifice. Jesus, our resurrection. Jesus, our salvation. Jesus, on that third day, rose and cleared the dust. He came to the upper room. Walked in. Cleared the dust. Thomas was a little bit dustier than others. You know Thomas? Well, if it's really you, then let me stick my fingers in your wounds. He didn't just want the dust to be cleared. He wanted to be certain. But it was changed. Life was changed because the dust had settled. Okay, today, we live in a world that's rambunctious around us, isn't it? Sin is flourishing. Things are going on. But understand this. The dust is settled. How many of you know Jesus Christ? How many of you know the sacrifice he made? How many of you accepted Jesus Christ and that sacrifice for your salvation? So there is no more dust. There is no more, what do we do? There is no more, oh no, what's going to happen now? We know that Jesus, who in there here in this scripture said in 3 days he will raise the temple again, raised the temple. We know that as he raised from the dead, he defeated death and sin forever. We know that he walked amongst man for 40 days, appearing here and there and in the crowds and doing different miracles and different things to show and prove he was there. And then we know that he ascended into heaven. And where is he today?
Right hand
of God. Doing what? Preparing a place for us. How many of you are having a place prepared? How many of you aren't too sure? It's okay not to be sure. How many of you don't have one being prepared yet? You see, in order to have a place prepared, you have to understand that the dust has settled. That Jesus has died, risen from the dead, living at the right hand of God, preparing a place for us, and that through Him and through His blood that was sacrificed, through a beautiful song that was sang for communion, I mean, to remember His body and His blood that was shed for us, so that we could what? Sit in church in a comfortable chair and hear the sermon of the air. No. I say it all the time. This is icing on the cake. And this icing makes no sense if you don't, during the week, bake your cake. How many of you baked your cake this week? How many of you took it out of the oven a little too early? How many of you have the ingredients on the counter but you've got to mix it? We do, don't we? We do. We know what God wants, and yet sometimes we let it sit. We know what we ought to do, but we don't do it. Or we start to do it, but then we get pulled away. That's like putting a cake in the oven and pulling it out too early. Anyone ever eaten a cake that was taken out too early?
Yeah.
Almost like pudding in the center? Yummy. Right? If you're going to do it right, you got to do it right. In Sunday school, they told us that we have to do what? Our best. Not the leftovers. Not what's left of the week, not what's left of the day, but our best goes to God. And you have to determine when's your best. I mean, we discussed Sunday school. Ken said, my best is early morning. When I'm up and going, early morning. Give it to God. Give Him that time when you're not dozing and sleepy and tired. You know, for some of you, it might be middle of the afternoon. You get home and you can sit down and have some time. Great. Middle of the afternoon for me if I start reading? Ken said it best. He goes, you ever do that? Start reading? Maybe you're reading your Sunday school book. Because you're tired, wore out. Some of us wait till, as the author put it, the last 3 minutes of the day. After we've laid it down in bed and we're there and we decide to start praying. And I asked in Sunday school, how many of you wake up still in prayer mode? You know, because we go to sleep praying and we left God hanging right there in the midst of the prayer. You got to let the dust settle. In our lives, the dust is settled. We know Jesus. We know His life. We know what He did for us. We know why He did it for us. And now He says this. And along the line last week, it's our time. We showed you that video 2 weeks ago. It's our time. It's our time to what? To speak up. It's our time to stand up. It's our time to teach. It's our time to sing. It's our time to preach. It's our time to do whatever God would have us to do for Him. It's our time. He did His part. He came and man, He dusted this world, didn't He? Life was going on this plane, and then Jesus. Amen. That's why the Pharisees and Sadducees were so mixed up and so hyper, because He came and He was changing what? Everything. It's no longer the law, but now it's grace and mercy. It's no longer on sacrifices, but now He is going to be the final sacrifice. I mean, He set the world on its ear. And He said here, and on the third day when I rise, then the disciples understood. Okay, what that tells me is we should understand it. We should know what He wants because the dust has settled. He did this over 2,000 years ago. He got it all set so that we could be what he would have us to be. And what is that? Three-letter word. Starts with an H. Ends with an is. His. Okay, he did it all that we could be his. You finally got that, didn't you? All sorts of you go. He did all that so that we could be his. And what does it mean to be his?
Give it up to others.
To what?
To give it to others.
To give it to others. To share? To what?
Go to heaven.
Go to heaven. To be his. The result is to go to heaven. But while we're here, to be his means to do what? His will. To live whose life? His life. This is his, right? Paul says, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. It's because I've changed. I gave this up. Seventh grade, Easter Sunday, walked an aisle in my brown, orange, tan, and black striped, double knit, bell bottom, cuffed pants. In my brown, wood wedged heeled shoes. In my orange, the best way to describe it is Partridge Family shirt. It was checks and yes, it was 70s. Yes, my hair was to my shoulders. Yes, I'm describing to you that Sunday. It is so vivid in my mind. Walking out from that aisle and walking forward, that day, I settled my debts. That day I put to sleep all those things that were there and I said, I choose him. I wish I had him today. But I mean, it's one of those that was a defining moment of life and I can't forget it. I mean, and I tell you about it all the time that on that Sunday I was like, bring it on, and on Monday I was tracing. And over a period of years, I had to get back to understanding the dust was settled. That I made a choice. And that choice was to be his. And in that choice of being his, I said that I won't live my life, but I'll live the life he wants me to live. Now, don't get me wrong. There were many a time I gave my life, and I took it back. Not proud of those times. Not happy about those times. Some of those times you will never know. You'll know that they exist because I tell you they exist. But I've worked all my life to give it more and more to Him so that my dust can be completely settled. Stand before you, tell you I'm not quite there yet, but I'm closer every day. What about you? What about you when you accepted Christ? You said you were going to be His. Did it change you? To change the way he changed the world. I mean, you can't meet Jesus, have a relationship with him, and not be changed. As I read my Bible, it tells me that I'm going to be changed. I'm going to be different. I'm going to be in the world, but I'm not going to be of the world. Yeah. In an instance, I was changed to being Tracy sinner, Tracy saint. Does that mean I don't sin anymore? It means this. His blood covers my sin. Not that I should just continue to sin, no, but that I should try to be like him. You see, there's this neat saying, every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. And that's what we're here about. Isn't it? To get rid of the past and to live the future. To get rid of the sin and live like the saint. To be what Christ would have us to be, to change our lives, to get the dust out that we can see what He would have us to be. Not just be, but do. See, I believe this. That every person in this room, God has a plan. And you're here this Sunday because this is part of that plan. That you sang the songs we sang, those words were meant to move you. to bring you close to his throne. And when close to the throne, we served you him, so that you could take in his power and his strength to be a part of you this day. That you could hear his word, that you could see that he had a plan. It wasn't just to clear the temple, it was so that they would understand what the temple was. You see, the temple was the center portion of life through the whole Old Testament. And what's the center of life in the whole New Testament? Jesus. In the Old Testament, it was a relationship with the priest and the different sacrifices in order to be forgiven and stuff like that. In the New Testament, it's that relationship with Jesus. That we no longer have to sacrifice, we just have to accept the sacrifice that was done for us. And acceptance of that sacrifice, then we settle our dust and we go to work. We settle the things of this life and we know that, okay, today is his day. What's tomorrow? His day. What's Tuesday? His day. Every day is his day. We have to understand that. So many people come to church on Sunday because this is his day, and the rest of the week they live like the devil. No. Every saint has a past, every sinner has a future, and that future is not in sin, but in Christ, in forgiveness, in grace, and in mercy, and that's what we're here today to do. To get ourselves set up to what? Face one more week. Face one more week. Face it how? On his terms. On his terms. Is your temple clear? Is the sins of this life out? You see, Jesus lives in me. We like to look at it as the heart. Jesus lives in my heart. Is my heart clean? Is my heart pure? Have I taken the needed precautions so that he has a place to abide and live in me, to work through me in this life to show others? How cluttered is your temple? How built up are they with sellers and merchants and other things of this life that aren't about Jesus? See, when I look at this story, it's not about cleansing that physical temple, it's about cleansing this temple. And does Jesus need to come in and take a bunch of cloths and put them together in a whip and whip me and throw me and get things out so that he can be? And I thought I settled that in seventh grade when I walked the aisle. And I said, here, this is yours. Here, do with me as you will. Use me and fill me. Make me wholly yours. Songs we sing and stuff we do, I mean, it's there. To remember this, the sacrifice he made. Not just today, but tomorrow. When we're in the trenches. When we're back at work or wherever we're going to be. To get it right. And Jesus settled the dust so many years ago that we could be here today. Understanding him, having a relationship with him, doing his work and his will. And the only question today is this. Are you? Are you his? Not partially, not kind of, not leftovers, we're talking to Sunday school. Are you his? Is he the first thing you think of when you wake up in the morning and the last thing you think of at the end of the day? Is he the person that takes you all the way through the day, that keeps you safe and guides you and directs you to keep you away from those sins? King, are you his? Has he settled your dust? Do you know your direction? Is he leading you to where you need to be? Every week we offer you a hymn of invitation. We offer you an opportunity to look and to see and to ask, you know, Is this it? Am I there? I ask that simple question. Are you here? We know from the Bible we can't serve two masters. We can't be his and the world's. If you have a foot in the world, you're missing out on his. And where are you today with him? If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and King, he's not yours. Until you accept him as his and as yours, he's not yours. He is not sitting at the right hand of the Father this morning building a place for you because he doesn't know you. If you continue on the path you're on right now, when you stand before him on Judgment Day, you're going to hear the words, "Depart from me, for I never knew you." Because it takes action today on your part to be his. To say, hey, I want to live that kind of life. I want to have that kind of person directing me, guiding me, and leading me. I want to be his and his alone. I want to be able to say like Paul, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Is that true? And if you need to accept Christ today, this is your opportunity to step forward and say, that's what I want. Or maybe you're like me. If you're like most of us, we like kicking up the dust sometimes, don't we? You're like me. You walked an aisle at some point and you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You were buried with him in baptism. You raised to live a new life, but you didn't live the new life. You went back to the same old thing. That took me years to get here, dang it. I'm telling you. I'm ashamed to say this, but sometimes in high school I was even ashamed to be his. It happens. But he's always there, isn't he? Arms open wide, waiting for what? The prodigal son or daughter to come home. And when we do, the party that he throws. Every time someone comes to Christ, can you imagine heaven? Can you imagine the celebration knowing that one came home? That's us. Today, if you call yourself his, if you call yourself a Christian, man, we've got to live it. We've got to let the dust of sin settle in our lives. And we've got to be about doing his work and his will. About doing those things he has us to do. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. We're going to give you an opportunity to look at that. First time choice, lifelong follower, I don't care. Today you have a decision to make. Are you going to be more his than you've ever been before? Are you going to do it right? Are you going to live it? Are you going to work it? Are you going to be it? Are you going to do his will the way he wants? When you get up in the morning, are you going to take it with you or are you going to go for the day without him? It's a choice every day. To live with him or without him. You gotta make that choice. So we're gonna stand and sing, and if you have a choice to make, make that choice.
Let me be his gold.
after the prayer, there's a video by Matthew West that seals this all. I mean, listen to the words, listen to what he says, and how he puts it. I mean, it tells you exactly where I was trying to go, what we're trying to do. You need to understand that it's you that God is relying on today to be the dust of this world to change it. Your dust is settled, and now you are His dust. And the change that He made in the world when He was here, He still wants us to make today. So I want you to watch that. We're going to pray and then do that. So just leave that run until the end of the video, okay? All right, let's pray. Father, we thank You for the day. We thank You so much for our ability to be here. Father, our ability to worship You. Father, to praise You, to honor You, to give You the honor and glory You deserve from our lives. And Father, we just pray this, that today we're Yours. That as we leave this place, we'll be Yours, to serve You, to honor You through the work that we do this week. Father, to lead others to You through us, that, Father, You can show them Yourself. And Father, just pray that You use us to do that. Guide and bless us, we pray in Your Son's name.
Disgusted me, so I shook my fist at him.